So, in terms of just reviewing and approving the minutes from our last meeting in October, anybody have any additions, edits, comments?
No.
If not, a motion to approve, those are there, okay?
Motion to approve.
Second, okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
One abstention.
One abstention.
Okay. And then Patty?
Okay, so.
Turn it over to you.
Thank you, David. I sent you the October financials. We're in good shape. I just want to point out a couple of things that were correct in the November report. When I look at this monthly, I have to manually adjust our payroll encumbrances, and there was a couple of errors which I corrected, but they won't show up till I print the November report. It's just one of our little quirks with the GL system. So if you look under principals, under the principals section on the bottom of the first page, it looks like we have $25,000 available, but we don't. That is encumbered for our for salaries. And on page two, it looks like we're over about 13 grand in our classroom teachers, but we're not. And those will correct in November.
Where is that one on page?
Page two.
Top 12A, you mean there? Yeah.
Yep.
Got it, okay.
But otherwise, you know, we've got a few small variances, and I'm still working to correct our, you know, we budget for classroom assistants, but then they get reassigned, so I'm still trying to manage where I budgeted versus where they're working, so they end up in the right bucket. So some of our assistant lines look like they're over, but they're not. I just got people in the wrong buckets, and I'm working to clear that up.
Thank you.
And you have 9 warrants to sign this evening in the amount of $128,254.30.
Okay. Anybody have any questions, Patty, about financial statement? No?
No.
Okay. We'll move right along. Next item here is public comment. We do seem to have some public here tonight. No, everyone's just here for a party. There's going to be one. Where is it? Okay. And record time. Unfinished business, none. No new business. School improvement plan.
Yeah, absolutely. So you have 2 different copies. One copy is in color, and then you have another copy that is black and white. The color copy is just for your reference. What it is a reflection of the school improvement plan from last school year. So the green were items that we achieved.
Okay.
Anything that you see in yellow were partially achieved.
Okay.
And then the items that were in red were things that we did not get to yet. And some of those items that are in red are carried into the new school improvement plan for this year. So I wanted to give you a copy of that just so you can see. I mean, I'm really proud. If you look at it, the amount of goals that have been identified really was widespread in many different areas. And I'm really proud of the work that everybody did to accomplish what we did accomplish. So a lot of progress was made in some of those areas. So moving on to the new school improvement plan for this year, we have 5 areas of focus: academics, community relations, safety, school culture, and special education. And I won't read everything, I'll just try to highlight for you, but you'll have this for your reference. So one of the big goals, and I've spoken a lot about this in the past year, is our work with Mike Anderson around differentiation.
Right.
So that is going to continue to be an area of focus for us. Mike is actually here today working with a group of teachers, and what, just to kind of, for Jan, to bring you up to speed a little bit, last year we brought in a national expert who is just a phenomenal teacher, and really a great rapport with, and just a connection with people who are just in it every day, educators that are in it every day, and just a really down-to-earth guy. So he's been doing a lot of work with Deerfield last year, and he's doing work with the entire district this year. We created a differentiation leadership team that has about 14 people, I want to say 13 or 14 people that are on it. And it's really looking at how are we differentiating instruction in the classroom around student choice. So we're continuing to do that work this year, and we're building capacity by having new members come and join the differentiation leadership team. So we've had...
How many of you are on the team or involved in the observations?
So there are some people that are here today. And what they do is they're actually going in, they're observing each other, they're providing feedback, and then they're learning about what to do in terms of student choice. And you saw the flexible seating that Tina brought you in on, which is...
Curriculum night too, it was really great. In the fifth grader, my student now is moving around, and it's really great to see the different classrooms set up and where they can do a standing desk and all.
Yeah, so that's an example.
Really nice.
Yeah, that's another example of what's come out of that. So that's part of our academic goal. Another piece are the new science standards. So that's a lot of the work that teachers are doing right now with Louise Law. You see co-teaching model and implementation of a workshop model. And what you'll see with the workshop model, you'll see it in a reading workshop, writing workshop, and you'll see a math workshop model in a lot of classrooms now. And just a really straightforward way where you're doing a mini lesson, students are going off and doing work independently, or teachers are pulling small groups, you're coming back to discuss as a whole group. And it's a powerful model no matter what the content or the discipline is. So those are the academic areas that we're focusing on. Community relations, we're going to continue to do activities with the community around Memorial Day, other national holidays. We did reach out to the town for a Veterans Day celebration. Unfortunately, they were unable. I had spoken to you about that.
Yes,
about that.
I talked to John after you spoke to him, and he just said, they didn't get in time. So.
I know.
He'd love to get involved.
So he's definitely booked us for Memorial Day.
Great.
So we're set for that.
That's great.
And then moving on to safety, which is kind of timely because tomorrow we're doing our reunification training. So the state police are coming in after school tomorrow. You're more than welcome to join us if you're interested. 3:15 to 4:15 to do a training on youth reunification and what that looks like. Because the goal is, Dr. Carey's, one of her big goals this year is safety across the district. And we will be doing a reunification drill at some point this school year. So it's really helping to prepare staff. What does it look like?
Right.
What does it mean? What are our roles?
Right.
So that's going to happen tomorrow, 3:15 to 4:15 in the cafeteria.
Okay.
I just want to add a little piece to that. When I was here before, we talked about moving the kids off-site and, and doing that. But since, since that day or since that time, we've looked at it, and Trooper Carmichael indicated it might be better just to do it here in this building, just so we know how to go through the process, as opposed to bringing children somewhere else. And not because it would bother the kids, they probably would have a ball, but it's probably not a great idea to let everyone know where our alternative place would be. Depending on if it was an evildoer versus a hazmat or some kind of thing. So we're just going to do it here and make it quick and easy, perhaps on a Friday early release, but just so people can understand the system.
Great.
Thank you.
Yep. What else? School culture. So this is something I'm going to talk a little bit more in depth about during the principal's report in terms of looking at a multi-tiered systems of supports for students. We have students, and I'll get into a little bit more with severe behavioral issues. We still have students that are struggling academically and looking at what are we going to do differently to be able to support those students. And I'll speak to some work with an outside consultant as well. So if I can put that on hold for a little bit and then get to that at the principal's report. And then finally, special education. We've been trying to be able to look at how we're delivering services for the students that have IEPs. And it's challenging. It really is challenging. So we've been meeting with special education liaisons and related service providers to be able to get some feedback, look at how we can improve some systems. What are the needs? What are the concerns? One of the things that Tina started this year was case management meetings every Friday. I don't know if you want to just briefly speak to that.
Yeah, we look at upcoming students, what the meetings are going to look like, some procedures and protocols, and it's, we're all together with related service providers and kind of working as a team, like a professional learning community, so it's been helpful, I think. We hope.
Yeah.
Do you think you have enough support for that? There's a ton of work that goes into, involved in all those IEPs and paperwork, reporting and meetings and.
Yes, it's more of what we're experiencing this year, the substitute coverage issue. So because here's the ripple effect, and Dr. Carey's aware of it, the Director of Special Education is aware of it, you know, we have absences during the day, and if we cannot, we're having a hard time obtaining substitutes for classroom teachers. So what ends up happening, because you have to cover the classroom, you're pulling instructional assistants to be able to cover those rooms, to have a just a smooth transition as possible. The end result is that the instructional assistant who may be working with students on IEP or 504, they're missing out on services. And it's really been, we've had a lot of discussions as with liaisons at the case management meetings. We don't have a solution right now.
Right.
Karen Ferrandino, the Director of Special Ed, said that because it could, the concern from teachers, understandably so, is that you're out of compliance.
Right.
By not being able to meet the service delivery grid and the hours that are on there, but we are showing our due diligence by doing what we can.
Right.
Advertising for substitutes. I reached out to parents. We had 3 or 4 parents that signed up to be substitutes since curriculum night.
Yeah.
And we're just trying to do the best we can.
What did Dr. Carey cover today?
Dr. Carey covered it in high school. She was, yes.
Judy over there, pre-K. You know, they were just adorable. But one of the things I would like to put out there on the table as a solution, and I'm not sure, because we're always looking for IAs. We're always, we have 3 openings in Sunderland now, and I'm not sure we're filled here even.
We are.
Okay. People, I think the problem with substitute teaching is that it's not considered like a full-time job. It's, you know, you're right. There, you come, you go, you come, you go. If we could hire a building, a floating sub that would just be dedicated to this building,
right.
So that we would have one built-in person that would be the sub wherever, wherever the highest need is, that person would be full-time with benefits, making possibly a little bit more than what a substitute makes, which is $75.
Right.
But if they're certified, they make a little bit more. But a building sub wouldn't be actually an IA. It would be a sub that would float around the building, and there would always be somewhere for them to be. And the beauty of that is they would know the different classrooms, and so, you know, Mary's going to be out. Mary, you know, a floating sub, I need you, and this is what we're in the middle of. Can you continue this, you know, so they get the plans and they would know the plans. Another thing we had talked about, and I talked with someone today, and I can't really remember the person I was talking to, but her, you know, her suggestion too, could we just hire lunch monitors? Somebody that would just come and do the 3 lunches and just watch the lunches. It's not really tough. It could be even a grandmother. I mean, it could be
right.
Somebody who's home or, you know, retired or something. And that would alleviate some of the times when our IAs are doing that kind of duty where they could be actually having their lunch or preparing or doing something more child-centered.
Right.
So those are 2 things. We need to look at the budget, and we need to look at, as we build the budget, where we're going.
Right.
But if there's a way, and if the school committee is willing, and the budget committee, and, you know, I would suggest, in this building particularly, to have a floating sub, or, you know, permanent sub is what we call it, a permanent sub, and hire a person who would get benefits, it would be a full-time job, and they would be the person not assigned to anyone. They would float the building wherever the need is greatest to help alleviate some of that. It's also hard when we're having training because there's such great high-quality training going on. And these teachers, particularly in this building, are very willing to get involved in it and are very much behind it. But taking them out of the classroom to either observe their peers or to work with Mike Anderson to watch him do a lesson or to watch
these kinds of things, it's very hard to take people out of the classroom so they can be trained.
Right.
And then on top of everyone being sick, just a little bit of time I was in preschool, I was sneezed on and,
yeah.
Get your flu shot.
Yeah.
But just to give you an idea, there were, 13 people out today, and how many subs did we not have?
We had 5 floating subs that weren't filled and 2 IAs that were out that were not filled.
Wow.
So it's 7 unfilled positions today.
And that's 5 to 7 a day unfilled is pretty much average.
Yeah.
Wow.
May I ask, are you, in this conversation, are you asking to find the funds to cover these folks or to find people to apply for these? I mean,
I'm trying to say is it might be easier to find someone for a full-time job in one building knowing what they're going to be doing every day as opposed to waiting and hoping a sub goes on to ASOP and picks our jobs.
Right.
Because subs, again, it's not a permanent job. If they're signed up in this district, they're probably signed up in Amherst or Greenfield or somewhere else.
Wherever.
Whoever gets in first.
Janine, were you just saying there are an average of 5 to 7 subs needed a day?
Unfilled. So we had probably about 10 to 13 folks absent a day, and then...
Not necessarily classroom teachers, obviously.
Correct.
So you just mean
right.
School personnel.
Right, and we're the largest building, so we're
right.
feeling it the most, but... That we know that every morning we were coming in between Jen Shumway and Tina and myself trying to figure out how we're going to cover the unfilled positions. That's what we spend the first 45 minutes of our day on every day. Mm.
Today was a little different with the 5 floating subs because we had training. So we had to cover for the people.
That makes it a little more challenging.
Mm. Because Mike was here.
Yep.
And they just historically, didn't we used to have lunch monitors?
Prior to my time, there were lunch monitors and they were eliminated as part of the budget process. There was a $4,000 line in the budget for the lunch monitors. I don't know how many that covered, but I do remember that being in the budget before my time.
It sounds familiar.
Definitely need to look at something here.
As we go into the budget season,
yeah.
Patty will be talking about that.
Any questions about the school improvement plan?
I have, I'm sorry, one question.
Yeah.
Reference faculty meetings, is that when you share this information? When do the faculty meetings happen?
For this Friday? Particular?
Yes, just any time, at least 3 faculty meetings will be devoted.
Right. So we try to do faculty meetings, we try to have some that, we have 2 faculty meetings a month. One is a morning meeting, we try to do nuts and bolts kinds of things with that. And then afternoon meetings, we usually get into some more meaty kinds of material or professional development. We've had teachers in the past present a workshop that they attend and that sort of thing. So that's when we dig into those. Yeah. That's only an hour we're going to pass. Sorry. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, are we voting on this school improvement plan or not?
Yes.
Yes, right now? Or next session?
Well, it says vote to approve school improvement plan.
I'm looking for what it says. Oh, underneath here. Okay, so first, I guess we can do that now and then go back up to the budget. So, can I entertain a motion to approve the school improvement plan as presented with a couple of modifications, I guess? You're going to add some things in or they're already added in?
No, the one that you have that's not in color, the black and white, that is the final.
So the stuff is added in there? Okay.
Yes.
There was something about phonics that I didn't see, but in red.
The reds made it to
that. The
I think the reds made it to this year's.
Some of the red did not.
Okay. So we're voting on a motion to approve the school improvement plan with whatever Janine is going to add in, if necessary.
Second.
Okay. Good. All in favor?
Aye.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks.
John? Yes. Both are fine.
Okay. And who would like to talk to us or present the proposed budget calendar? Anybody ever would like me to go?
Okay, so it's that time of year again. So we put together our budget calendar, and these are some pretty aggressive deadlines. So starting next week, the principals will be meeting with myself and Dr. Carey for our initial FY work sessions, FY 18 work sessions. And then during the week of December 5th, Dr. Carey and I will be meeting with our district administrators, our director of technology, our director of facilities, our curriculum directors, those types of folks, to see what their goals and desires are. And then we will be putting together our budgets, and the principals and myself will again meet with Dr. Carey the week of December 12th to look at our first initial draft. We will be working from the 12th to the 30th to come up with our final budget packet, and we will begin our deliberations here in Deerfield at our meeting of January 4th. The only reason I say it's aggressive is because when we built these, I did tend to forget that we're going to be moving one whole week. So I have to find a way to move and work at the same time. So, and then we will continue our budget deliberations on February 1st, which is our next school committee meeting. Around February or March is usually when the town asks us to come and present the budget to the select board and their finance committee. And then on March 1st, we'll hold our public hearing, and then you will have your meeting. And one of the recommendations from last year was to post the public hearing with the meeting immediately following, because we post the public meeting at 6, it lasted to 6:15, but then your meeting wasn't posted till 7, and we had to wait 45 minutes to have the meeting. So we're going to post it immediately following, so that we don't have to, we can take a break, but we won't have to be locked into that start time.
Sounds good.
And then Deerfield's town meeting is April 24th. I believe you will be first this year, as you were last year in the town meeting orders. And then on May 1st, I believe, is your town elections.
Great.
Sounds good. We're meeting in December for first week. You mentioned something about maybe us having some deliberations here?
No, January 4th.
January 4th. Are we not meeting in December?
But we're still preparing the
budget.
But
you're still preparing. Okay. I just thought I heard you say something about it.
So I will try to get those out via email so that you will have time to look at them before January 4th.
Right.
But that's what I'm saying. I'm going to attempt to do that, but it's aggressive.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Maybe I'm going to do this before and just be there waiting for
you. Where is everybody? Anybody
have any questions about the budget timeline, calendar? No? Okay. Thank you much.
Thank you.
How about reports? Start with the collaborative.
Anybody, I don't think there's anything. We haven't had a meeting since.
No?
So there's a meeting coming up shortly.
So the reports we like.
One report is just, I'll wait for the meeting report? I'll wait for superintendent's report, because it's got a good report.
And Janine, you're up next?
Yep. So I don't have a written report, because I really want to share with you some things that have been, it's been an unusual fall. And I kind of wanted you to have as much of a big picture of what it's been looking like. I think Trevor, you experienced it one time when we were in Norway.
Sure. Yep.
But it has been a really unusual year. And what I mean by that is that we've been noticing many students in our early childhood programs that are coming in with severe behaviors. And what I mean by severe, we're talking about students that are having tantrums, students that are incredibly dysregulated, students that are physically aggressive, eloping, those kinds of things. And it is, it's been felt throughout the building.
Mm.
It's having a huge impact, not only in the preschool and in the kindergarten wing, but it is having a huge impact across the building. And everybody's been working really, really hard to try to help these students, because these are kids in crisis.
Mm-hmm.
What I want to also preface this with is that this is not something that is unique to Deerfield. So for the past, all of last year, I attend the principal meetings at the collaborative, mm-hmm. and this has been a topic. Principals are able to, at those meetings,
bring agenda items that they wish to speak about. And it, every time it's come up, every time. And I have Pioneer Regional School District, they added a new preschool program to specifically work with students with severe behaviors. Williamsburg Elementary School added a behaviorist for the same reason. Irving, they were looking at doing something. I mean, everybody is faced with this challenge, and there's some research, and Kim, I invited Kim McCarthy, our director of early childhood, to talk a little bit maybe about that. So we need to do something different. We can't keep doing the same thing for these students. So there's been a lot in place, and I'd like to even go back to last year, 2015-16 school year, where Kim and Tina and Molly Brenner, who is a teacher that runs the Horizons program over at Sunderland, they've done training with the early childhood staff throughout the year. Kim, how many, do you know about how many sessions you may have had?
Well, we met monthly. We designed an executive functioning cohort that was a district-wide cohort with pre-K teachers and related service providers. And Susie here was a big part of that to build capacity and understanding of really what's going on brain-wise and behavior in the classroom.
Because we saw it percolate. We saw that this was coming. With that, in the summer, Kim and Louise Law and Tina and myself met to talk about a multi-tiered system of supports and what we could do to support not only the students with these behaviors, but other students that have academic needs and that sort of thing. And then we had asked staff members, related service providers, who met on September 6th to talk about what that might look like. An example of it is that we have Sue Boraski, our OT, going into kindergarten classrooms with one of our speech pathologists and doing whole class lessons for students to teach them some of these skills, because they need direct, explicit instruction in these skills. They don't have it. Administration met with Dr. Carey four times since the fall to share some of the concerns that we have, and she's been incredibly supportive. We added an additional instructional assistant to a particular classroom that had a lot of high needs. And we met with the director of special education multiple times, and then we looked at bringing in an outside consultant. The consultant came and observed twice last week and spent time strictly in kindergarten, in the kindergarten classrooms, because we have about 4 to 5 students right now that are very, very high need. Mm-hmm. And administration met with the consultant on this past Monday to get recommendations and how we can move forward and what can we do. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that we're talking about, the other piece I do want to say is that, you know, we've been listening to staff over the past year and a half. What can we do differently? Because mm-hmm. we knew this was coming.
Yeah.
Our early childhood teachers met, they had release time yesterday, and provide us with suggestions and recommendations. And similar to things that we were talking about and what we were considering on doing. So what we are planning to do is to post and advertise a new position, and it would be an early childhood behavioral interventionist. And it's really about building capacity and trying to have someone who can explicitly teach skills and self-regulation skills mm-hmm. and to support students, because the goal is to keep them in the classroom. Right. So we're not talking about a substantially separate program,
right,
like our Life Skills, our LEAP program. We're talking about having a space in the building where students, if they need to come out of the classroom, they can go into that space. They might have some academic support in that space, but also get some other things that they need. Kim, can you talk a little bit more specifically?
Yeah, I think a lot of it is around pre-teaching and practicing social, emotional skills, functional communication, ways to calm the body before we enlarge in the group for them, if you will, and have them apply the skills. We see it as a real fluid service for kids as opposed to an assigned classroom. But we would have a classroom that would have an academic component, a self-regulation component, and a place where children can, with dignity, kind of pull themselves together that's away from that hallway where we have now, so a place where they can come in and really regroup and reset themselves. That person that we would plan to hire would do professional development around behavior. We'll have a home component that they can reach out and support our families and our communities in a bigger way and be really involved early on for that prevention and remediation with the hopeful eye on lessening the intensity over the course of the child's experiences here at Deerfield.
I fully support what you're doing on this. The conference at the Cape last week was completely and wholly all about social emotional learning and the impact that it's having on the schools is just immense. Mm-hmm. And it's like you said, it is everywhere, and it's teaching the whole child and helping. I'm glad you said home, because it's helping the families and bringing them involved and just trying to get as much resources to that whole child as you can, because it has to happen really early. So wherever you can do that, I'm completely in support of that.
And that's the key piece, the early intervention. Mm-hmm. Because if we really look at, you know, 4 to 5 students right now, if we were to send these students out of district, it would cost us over $200,000. Mm-hmm. So we're looking at building capacity. Right. You know, we're seeing more and more of these students. This is a pattern. This isn't going to go away.
No.
So this is something that we have to develop our skill sets. The consultant that we have been working with is going to come back on the November 18th and December 2nd, train teachers and train instructional assistants. And then we are looking at having all kindergarten and preschool teachers trained in restraint, CPI. Mm-hmm. Obviously a last resort, but we feel that, you know, you're in situations where you want to make sure that students are safe.
Right.
So it's been a really challenging year, and our early childhood faculty and staff have been really working incredibly hard to try to service these students and give them what they need. And it's the challenge is that the curriculum's not getting any easier. The expectations for educators isn't getting any easier.
Right.
And you have this other layer to it.
Right. And it's go ahead.
I was going to ask, do you find with these particular kids and families that they're accessing appropriate services outside the school?
That's one of the things that we're trying to do. So we have been working with clinical support options for a couple of families right now to be able to do just that. So that's a piece of it. And our school psychologist and our new school adjustment counselor are also involved in talking to families to be able to give them supports and resources that they could reach out to.
And I'm just wondering if there's some way, if you have a critical mass of people, whether there's someone from the outside who can sort of collectively given some of the social emotional learning, that sort of good child therapist activity, some of that it sounds like would fall into that boat. Whether there's a way to get someone who comes here to do that, who then builds appropriate insurance, and so you're getting hours in the building, and somebody's also able to bill for it. And, I mean, I don't know enough about the rule of separating both the things, but it seems like somebody who could fit that mold could help attack some of these. But I guess also just that making sure that those families are being encouraged, obviously, to get what they can outside. It shouldn't be our job to do that, but that's what's happening.
But it is where we're at.
Yeah.
And I think,
and even Department of Children and Families, kids who are in crisis can help provide resources to certain kids. Maybe
outside services are really hard to get for some, particularly. If you have private insurance, it's really difficult to negotiate that system.
Yeah. Well, sometimes the waiting list to get an appointment is 6 to 9 months to get an appointment.
Right. Yeah.
Because we're so limited in this area. And if that's not unique to Franklin County. The same thing happens in Hampshire and Hamden County, too. The wait list to get a child services is 6 to 9 months.
And then in terms of our district, is it so much of it that we could be sharing somebody, or are you thinking of somebody here full-time because the need is here?
It would full-time. Be full-time to build capacity at Deerfield, because we do want to keep these students here.
So my question is, how does the school adjustment counselor fit in because the school adjustment counselor is a clinician, how is that fitting into this team?
Part of the crisis team, absolutely, and the school psychologist as well. I mean, between Helena, who's the school adjustment counselor, Giselle, the psychologist, Tina, and myself, we really have been running around, literally. Dr. Carey has observed it, to be able to address students who are running through the building, having temper tantrums. So the school adjustment counselor will be doing, and the school psychologist, some groups, social skills groups, and anxiety and anger groups and that sort of thing. But where we've been right now since the beginning of the school year, very reactionary. Mm-hmm. It doesn't feel good. It really doesn't feel good. We have to do something different.
And I wonder, is the, we should really, and you probably are, but reach out to the collaborative, because they're doing a ton of work on this right now. Okay. And they're ramping up their, you know, education. And, right, you're nodding. Yes, they're doing a ton of work on this. And I do feel like it is a, it is an issue that can be addressed and can be fixed. The kids can get healed, they can move on. So if we catch them early enough and put the effort in and the resources in to catch them soon, otherwise it's, you know, it's 18 years of dealing with that.
Absolutely.
So I definitely support your help on that.
So we will be advertising. My hope is tomorrow, I can get that ready and up. There will be faculty that will be in staff that will be part of the interview committee, mm-hmm, with Tina and Kim and myself.
And we would be using school choice funds,
okay,
to support financially that position.
Can I ask a practical question? Are they identified prior to their start here, or do they acquire a...
So it's a mixed bag.
Yep.
So it's definitely, because we're talking about 4 soon-to-be 5-year-olds coming to our school and young development, and what does that look like? So out of the 5 kids that we have, 2 have been identified officially. We have 2 more in process, and one we're keeping a very close eye on. But it's really, you know, they've been on this planet for such a short period of time, and they're coming with wide range backgrounds. I think you were kind of talking about trauma in the home and the toxicity that's out there on multiple levels, the lack of play opportunities because of our lifestyles have changed. So there's multiple factors that feed into this maladaptive behavior. What we don't have as an industry medically or research-wise is why can some persevere and jump over while others, it becomes a devastating factor in their life. But what we do know is, regardless, if we start working on that brain architecture and building in the strategies and the positive solutions for them, that we actually are rewiring the brain, and they have enough research about around that now that it is so important to do starting at 3 years old to really develop that. So that's why the focus is pre-K and K.
Right.
But yeah, it's very challenging. Mm-hmm.
So we shared this information this morning at a faculty meeting, kind of an impromptu meeting. That's why we have a lot of faculty members here.
Yeah.
Because they are working really hard, and it's overwhelming, it's exhausting, and it's incredibly stressful, and they're here because they want what's best for their students.
Right.
So,
and they keep showing up every day. No one's changed careers. You know, it's incredible. It's incredible to be on this team.
I'd like to add a piece of information. I know this is more of a report than a discussion, but just so that we all can have an idea of how you are seeing it impacts the whole school. We have a child who came to kindergarten with good behavior, and we started seeing things that we'd never seen before, and his teacher was saying the same things, and it, you know, he was learning these things at home, and it was, of course, like upsetting for us as parents to realize that he was learning things at school that weren't great, and then bringing them home, and, you know, we've felt a lot of support in how to, like, fix this and work with them, but I see where, you know, when you say, like, it impacts the whole school, and it's not just here, but it's at home, and so thank you for addressing the issue.
Thank you.
And does the faculty feel like that this is like moving in the right direction? Yeah. Getting help.
I'll take this opportunity. You know, we've had in Greenfield, you have the Franklin County Big Brothers Big Sisters program, and I think we've had some success linking up high school students with younger children. So I don't know if that's a middle ground between an expert and whoever. Yeah.
I've already started those relationships. We have two high schoolers coming into our preschool program now, but we're at the very infant stage, stages of that. But I agree.
Great.
I agree that all those kinds of connections and that really pro-social constant is good. It's really good. So yeah.
And the tricky part is we're not, as educators, we go to school, we're not trained as behaviorists. Right. Tina is an exception to that, but I'm learning every day. I'm trying to figure out and questioning, did I do the right thing? Did I make the right decision? Did I use the right language with this student? Did I escalate the student more? And right. We have to develop new skill sets as educators because it's no longer just about delivering curriculum.
Right.
But we will keep you posted. We're hopeful.
Thank you for the work you're doing.
It's a process. We've been talking about this for a year and a half now. So
yeah.
It just takes time.
Let us know what we can do to help.
Thank you.
Yeah. Mr. Chair, it would help my records greatly if you would take a vote on the use of the school choice funds to fund the position.
Okay. We're not really... How much? Well, I mean, just a random. You want an appropriation?
Yeah. Well, just be able to fund the position using available school choice funds would be fine. Because we don't know. It's going to depend on their education, their experience level.
Can we know what we have currently in school choice and what a range?
Sure. If you look on page, if we go back to our report on page 6. Right now, we're scheduled, and again, this is going to be impacted by my moving of the IAs. We budgeted $589,190, and right now, it's looking like we would not be spending about $100,088.63 of that. Even when I fix the IAs, we have about we're using $80,000, about $80,000 less than we had planned on using. So there is, I know we want to have some savings, but we had some savings with this budget, and I don't have those exact details with me tonight. I'm sorry about that. But I do feel comfortable in saying to you that we can fund this position for at least the remainder of the year without doing any significant damage to our savings in the school choice fund.
The other detail I would like to add is that currently we have two students in the WINGS program up in Conway that are sixth graders. So they will be graduating. That's $76,000 right now that we will not have that cost for next year. So,
Okay.
So if I can just rephrase that, Annie, did you just say that really you're asking for a vote because it's changing the budget somewhat, but you're basically saying that the budget that you gave us for this year, by approving this new position, we're not going to add to it at all?
No.
Okay.
But because it is a new position, I'm asking you to identify and vote the funding source.
I understand that. But just to be clear, but you're not really asking us to make some big decision here that's impacting next year's budget, except the position continues. Obviously, that's something we have to deal with.
Correct.
In budget discussions.
Then that's what Janine is saying, is that we're for next year's budget, we're looking to free up some tuition that would then cover the cost of this position.
And it does impact next year's budget to the extent that we're taking however much we take out of school choice this year, out of the school choice funds that will be available for next year's budget.
Right.
In essence, that's what we're doing. We're taking it out of the reserves that we had entering the year.
No, because we budgeted 589, and it looks like we have $100,000 savings, so we're already not spending the 589. So we had planned to use 589, and we're using only 489. So by adding on, we're still below what we thought we were going to be this year.
Mm-hmm. So this is just out of the 2017 school choice funds.
Correct.
Because we carried a balance forward from
2016
funds.
Correct.
Okay.
And I can bring that analysis for the November meeting so that you can see where we were and where we are now.
That would be good.
Okay.
I'll make a motion to fund this position using the school choice fund.
Second. based on Patty's representations, that we're not increasing our overall annual budget this year. Not saying we should,
correct,
if we needed to, but just the representation is that we're not.
So we're made it.
Okay.
Great.
Any further discussion about that?
Second.
Okay. Anybody have any other comments? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Looks like it's unanimous.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Anything else?
That's it?
That's it?
Okay. Oh, so yeah, I've got the reunification training tomorrow, so.
Yes.
Interested.
Yes.
Like, this was something you would like to see.
Definitely.
Great.
Thank you. So, the superintendent's report, I'm going to get to, there's two things I did want to talk about that might be of interest. Today we had a situation where the, a road was closed due to a water main being opened up.
Hillside Road was closed.
It was actually for the repaving of a previous water main break.
And they closed it and didn't notify anyone, so the bus couldn't go up there. Parents were saying the bus didn't come, and then they tracked it down, and apparently the road was closed by the, not the road department, not Kevin, but the water commissioner. And that person didn't notify anyone. He said he called dispatcher or something and left a message, but we were able to send the kids home on the bus.
All students either there were two different robo emails that you may have seen if you were a parent, because of misinformation that was provided to the school. So it was a little confusing and frustrating, incredibly frustrating. And Chief Pachorik is equally as frustrated.
I can imagine.
But all the students, one student returned back on the bus at the end of the day, and parents were contacted and was picked up quickly. But other than that, everyone else was
able to get home
safely, yeah.
So if you hear anything, there's a problem when you don't follow procedure.
Yeah.
And so that's what happened. Mm-hmm. And as Principal Heil was trying to keep up with the information, and then it changes, and it's very hard to keep parents notified.
Yeah. And it was uncomfortable because the first communication said the road was open, and then about 20 minutes before dismissal, I received information that it was actually not open.
Oh, boy.
And trying to send information and have parents figure out really quickly. And as the chief, I talked to Brian Ravish, our school resource officer, and he said really the procedure is that the chief of police has to approve all road closures, and that did not happen.
So it was unplanned, and then it was not communicated. So,
that's even better.
But not us.
But everyone was safe. So that's
great. Thank you for managing that.
That's true. So another thing, some infrastructure with the building. In one of our kindergarten classrooms, a cabinet was removed to look for something to deal with the new roof. They were looking, checking on something, and they found mold. And it was quite extensive from a leak that had happened years, you know, mm-hmm. before the roof was you know, replaced, but it had been growing. So last night, Bob Lesko, he's wonderful. He called in an abatement company to kill all the mold, and they did it like that. They did it following all the procedures and protocols, and they, you know, cleared up, you know, everything. You know, they cordoned off everything, killed all the mold. They actually have not finished replacing all of the sheetrock or whatever the wall is, but they put the bookshelf back because they didn't want it to tip. It was too dangerous. So for safety's sake, it's back there. Hopefully they're going to come in on Friday and follow that just to make sure that leak line, to make sure that it didn't impact any other classroom. But getting in there and killing the mold isn't the hard part, you know, but then we have to pull out everything and then replace, and there's a little bit of cost involved. But we just wanted you to be informed that they took care of it like that, and hopefully Friday, which there's no students in school, hopefully they can get in there and just pull out another bookshelf in another room and just make sure that it's all, yeah.
And I might add that as a result, because it wasn't
proper environment to have students and staff in. It was March Pierce's class, March is here. She was a trooper and Mary Dancer and her staff, and they have been having, they had class today in the library. Library was moved into the classrooms, and at one point I had walked in, and the students were having lunch, and it was like they had been here all year in the library, so she did a fabulous job.
Like a vacation.
And they will be in the library again tomorrow, so we appreciate the flexibility of everybody, so teamwork.
So it, running a building this size, it takes, you know, it's just always something.
Right.
It's just always something. So anyway, to the superintendent's report. Trevor and I went to the Mass Association of School Committees and Mass Association of School Superintendents Joint Conference. Trevor was there, Bob Decker from Frontier, Michelle Tomlinson from Sunderland, and then from Conway, we had Elaine, Phil, and Ashley. And it was wonderful, and I have to comment with Trevor on some of the workshops. I went to an OPEG workshop, legal considerations. There were other ones, district governance programs, social emotional learning, Chapter 78, building and managing relationships. But the one that really struck me too was practical strategies for supporting children with anxiety-related oppositional behaviors. And it's hard, one thing that struck me, because the speaker, she was wonderful, and she just kept bringing out example after example of children that were looking to be oppositional, out of control, not self-regulated, not, you know, just running on impulse. And it's hard to look at a child like that and think it's anxiety related. You know, the child is experiencing anxiety, something's really wrong in his life or her life, and it's hard to look at that and, you know, and say, this is anxiety. You know, usually you think somebody would be meek and mild and depressed and sad, and instead of out there screaming and yelling and jumping on chairs and hopping along the, I've seen, you know, some interesting behaviors. So, and they did talk a lot about certain behavior plans that just don't work. The run-of-the-mill garden variety behavior plan where there's incentives doesn't work. It really doesn't, because they can't, they just can't seem to conceptualize it. It just, it is not, it's just meaningless. And we need to find ways, and hopefully this this person that we would hire would help us find ways to help the children to develop that intrinsic motivation inside them that they want, you know, they want, they need. And really what they're looking for, clearly, and we all know this because we're all, you know, armchair psychiatrists, but we know they want attention. And we know that they're doing negative behavior, they're engaging in negative behavior to get our attention. But if we could find ways to meet that need, that works. And one of the suggestions that she went on, and she talked a little bit about how, you know, you could just say to a student, I'll be back in, you know, 3 minutes, just, you know, save all your questions, I'll come back. But those are children who can reason a little bit more. I think students that are 4, 5, and 6 years old, they don't have that that time idea, they don't have that the concept of waiting, patience, you know, putting off delayed gratification. So it's a tough thing we're talking about. It's a tough thing, and it is all over. When Trevor and I were in the room, it was packed. I mean, it was standing room only, and there had to be 500, 600 people in the room.
Yeah.
It was huge. I mean, but it was very telling, and I went back another day, and I don't know, I think you might have been in there. I went the second day, and it was very, very good.
Really great program.
So we learned a lot, and we engaged a lot, and thanks, Trevor. Thank you. And so it was really valuable time, and I would ask anyone else to go. So the Union 38 students, grades 3 to 6, will be taking the computerized MCAS test this year. Instead of paper and pencil, we chose the option to go computerized to help us in this school, in our schools, to transition into what the computerized version will look like, how it will go,
how the students will adjust, give the students exposure to it, and one of the big benefits of doing it will be held harmless, which means our scores won't impact one way or the other as we transition into this. So we had the option of doing paper pencil, except in fourth and eighth grade, and we chose computerized for everyone so that we would be held harmless as we learn the ins and outs of the MCAS 2, which is a new test, computerized, which is a new experience. So that's what we're doing, and we are making arrangements to make sure that we will have Chromebooks available for all the testing windows for each of the grades, and so that the kids can actually take the test in their own classroom where they're familiar, or with their own people that they're familiar with. They're not going off to a computer lab where everything is, you know, different. We're also doing the NWEA MAPS test in January to help, you know, give them a little training again, you know, and so we're excited about that coming, and we can't fight it, so we might as well join it. That's what I say, but anyway. So I wanted to talk a little tiny bit about the Massachusetts Rural School Schools Coalition and Senator Stan Rosenberg and the RISE Act that he's trying to get passed through. My understanding is this year he got it through the Senate but not the House, but the RISE Act is slightly different than the Rural Schools Coalition. The RISE Act is about charter schools and putting some more sanctions on charter schools so that we can level the playing field, so to speak, so that they would have, you know, to have school, you know, more representation on their school boards, that they would have to have teachers that are certified through the state as opposed to uncertified teachers. And we're hoping that some of these level playing field, that they would also consider taking students who are not the easy top students of any given school, you know, taking the best and then leaving public schools, you know, because we take every child that comes to us and we meet their needs and we try really hard to meet their needs. What my experience has been is that charter schools will take our kids if they have special ed so that they can say they've taken special ed kids, but then they send them right back and say, well, we can't meet their needs here. But they've already said that we've taken these special ed kids, but then they move them right out. So, and then we take and try to bring them back up to where they were and move on. Also giving us, helping us a little bit with the burden of paying for charter school tuition by perhaps $1,000 more per student. The Massachusetts Rural Schools Coalition has been developed, spearheaded by Mike Buonacatti, and he is the superintendent at Mohawk Regional. And he's working on his doctorate, and he put this idea together where schools with declining enrollment would get their Chapter 70 funding. Rather than using the flat funding formula that they use to determine Chapter 70 based on our enrollment and then our our property values, and it works better for urban districts where there's many more students as opposed to rural districts where our population is declining, and so it's a series of tiers that would provide more funding per student depending on where you are and what your demographics are. Instead of using the flat formula, it's a set of tiered allocations determined by tiers of declining student enrollment, eligibility, and targeted aid. One thing that I can totally agree with, small schools, they offer so much. There's so many benefits to small schools as opposed to the big urban schools, but the cost of operating the smaller schools is pretty high. Now, I went to a coalition meeting a couple weeks ago. There were probably 15 superintendents there. We were all there. Stan Rosenberg was there. And one of the things that Mike Buonacatti asked is, you know, go to your school boards or your school committees and ask them to support this. And I'm not doing that tonight. I'm coming to you and I'm informing you that I've been engaged and I am still doing research on it. I'm not sure. I think there might be drawbacks. I'm not exactly positive of what they are. I need to do more research. I need to talk to more people. But I also wanted you to be aware of it. It's out there and you'll read it in the paper. I'm sure it's been in the Recorder. His design has been, you know, and he's had several articles about it. And I just really want to know more about it before we become involved. But it's out there and it's good because we are declining enrollment and we do need, we need a different formula than the Chapter 70 that people in Boston use. When there's 100 people per square inch, you know, we've got 100 miles per one. So that's my report for this month.
All right.
Can I ask a question?
Absolutely.
How soon will a comparable ballot question be made again? Is there some, given that two was rejected?
Mm-hmm.
Is this a yearly question that will come up? I mean, is there some time that needs to pass before a similar proposal is made?
You know, I would say it won't happen for a while. I could be wrong, but they spent millions of dollars, and that was outside of the state money. That was big business money. They spent millions. One of the things, and Trevor was there, one of the luncheons we had, they talked about this professor from, I think it was Dartmouth, UMass Dartmouth, and he had written the articles on the dark money. And he got up there and he said, I can just tell you this, I don't know anything about charter schools, you know more than I do, I'm not for them, I'm not against them, but I can tell you when I follow the money, it comes from dark areas. We can't figure out who they are. They're from out of state, they're big business, they're covering it with, you know, Committee for Equal Schools or Committee for Good Schools or whatever. So they spent a lot of money, they lost. I think it was a pretty good, I think people spoke really well when it was voted. It wasn't an even kind of, I don't think it'll come up again for a while, but I do have to say, I don't think charter schools are going away. They're not. And they still have many charter schools that haven't even been, they have the opening, the license for charter schools or whatever, but they haven't even been used yet. So they're still, you know, they're still, yeah, there's many options out there for charter schools and they're not going away. So I don't know if they're going to talk about funding.
So there are some already in the pipeline that haven't come online yet. So,
And there's some that there's still. There's still room. They're still like. They still have. I don't know how many that they can do, but nobody's done them yet. So why they push this thing for 12 more each year every year? I don't know because they still have the capacity. I know, that probably wasn't very clear.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else have any questions, Superintendent? No? I think we have no reason to go to executive session, so a motion to adjourn would be
second.
Appreciated. Second, if you're all in favor.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, well, anything else?
No,
oh, you were saying
who did this first? Is it John?
A motion to adjourn.
Yes.
Okay, who was the second?
I second.
Thanks.
I was always desperate to end.